They arrive at sunset. Sometimes 100. Sometimes 1,000. They are Ethiopian refugees, fleeing the war and famine in their country, bringing with them only their clothes, their dignity, their hope for a future. Most of them have walked more than 8 weeks to reach this border camp between Ethiopia and Sudan. As they enter Wad Cowley, their movement is slow, labored. They are tired and hungry.
This camp is completely impossible. It cannot stay here. It's monstrously large. It's probably the largest settlement of humans between Qadaraf and Juba. It's almost 100,000 people now, and this is a quite impossible size for a refugee camp.
The refugees are unaware that their journey has brought them out of one hell and into another. They will sit through the night with nothing, waiting to be registered so they can receive their small ration of food. The children are quiet, too dazed, too sick to cry or to care. It is dawn at Wad Cowley. Refugees, still wrapped in blankets from the night's chill, sit huddled by their cooking fires. There is a sense of timelessness here, like a scene with no beginning or end, torn from the scriptures. A grain truck arrives with desperately needed food. Families return from the woods where they've gathered sticks for their fires and their huts. There is no sanitation. Disease and death rates are out of control. People collapse in fields full of human defecation. Sickness and misery are everywhere. Children who were brought here by parents desperate to keep them alive die waiting for someone to help.
50% of the people who are dying, the children who are dying, or 50% of the people who are dying of measles. And we're doing the children who are from 6 to 12 years of age. The reason we're doing them is because two-thirds of those who are dying are of that age and they haven't been vaccinated yet.
15,000 children have been vaccinated at Wad Cowley in the last 2 weeks, but medicine to curb the epidemic is running out.
We have enough for about another 1,000 vaccines. That's it.
Martha Ryan, a nurse from San Francisco, registers and vaccinates children and checks them for malnutrition.
The hardest part of my job is seeing so many children that need so much and not being able to do for them. Because people come in here and they'll ask me to give them a note saying that they could go to the feeding center, but they might be too old, and yet they really do need help. And it's hard to have to turn people away when you know that they all need some help.
I'm going to pass a tube through the nose and into the stomach, and we're going to start feeding the child through that until we get her back to a normal fluid level.
At the camp, there are two intensive feeding centers for the most severely malnourished.
All right, there you go. That's nice. Good. Easy does it. Okay, I'm afraid they don't like it. This is a very effective way of feeding these children.
Many of the children suffer from a number of complications caused by their malnutrition.
There's no elasticity at all in the skin and the stomach. It's a bit like dough, really, when you pull it up, which is a sign of severe dehydration. This child's probably got diarrhea and just hasn't been drinking enough, which is a very, very common problem here. We're getting a lot of children dying from dehydration. And she sounds like she might have some pneumonia as well.
1,200 children come to the feeding center every day. Between 30 and 40 of them, like this child, may die.
This child has pneumonia, is dehydrated, has very bad dysentery, and is suffering from severe malnutrition.
What kind of chances for life did you give this child?
About, less than 50-50.
God must be punishing us because of our bad deeds, but still we must trust him, because there is no one else to trust.
Tikli is a Christian priest from the Ethiopian village of Geralta. He came to Wad Kauli a month ago with 700 people from his village. After years of drought, there was nothing left there. The land had withered, the cattle had all starved, and the villagers had eaten all their planting seed. And so in desperation, Tikli and his people began a six-week walk across the desert in search of food. Many of them died on the way. Now, a third of his people are sick. The priest lives in a hut with Alameo, a farmer from Tikli's village. Alameo and his wife Leita Broughton take care of two boys whose parents collapsed on the walk to Wad Kauli. They live together in a tiny shelter with four other families. Yesterday, Leita Broughton's sister Mendine arrived at the camp with her three children. She buried her husband on the way.
He became sick from hunger. He died a week ago. He died on the walk.
In the camp, food is distributed to the village elders. Alameo tells us lately there is only sorghum flour, and some of the flour is mixed with dirt. Camp officials admit that profiteers have tampered with it.
It smells like urine.
Alameo doesn't report the bad flour or complain, afraid there will be no food to eat that night. Even the most miserable things are better than nothing. In a hollowed-out log, Leita Broughton ferments the flour for cooking. Families wait in line at the fire, and because there are no plates, take turns using the same metal sheets to cook the bread. This bread makes my family sick, Alameo says, but we will eat it. We must. We must eat the bread to stay alive. It is our only hope.
We put in two measuring sticks over here, and we measure every day the drop in this river, and it's going down now about 2 centimeters every day. When I came here 20 days ago, I could still see, I couldn't see any of these mud tongues leading out into the river, and you can see it going down every day, and it's going down so fast.
At Wad Kauli, the refugees are drinking the river dry. Relief officials estimate the camp needs 200 truckloads of water a day as a bare minimum. There is no way to get that much water into Wad Kauli. The roads are inadequate. There are not enough trucks, not enough fuel. The water that's left in the river can make Alameo's family sick, so he digs a hole in the riverbed to find a less contaminated source. It takes time. Survival requires patience. The refugees are supposed to chlorinate the water before returning home. Many do not. Back in the hut, Alameo shares his water. Minutes later, Mindine's 10-year-old son becomes sick. Mother, he cries. She looks on helplessly and tries to comfort her son. It will take Alameo an hour to walk 1 mile for the straw he needs to cover the boy's vomit. He is a young man, but his face is deeply lined from years of hunger and worry. For 3 years, he watched his crop slowly dwindle away and his cattle die of starvation. When he is alone, he thinks about his mother who was left behind in Ethiopia, too weak to make the walk to Wad Kauli, and he wonders if she is still alive. They are praying for the resurrection of Christ. They are praying that all they have endured, the hunger, the suffering, and death, will one day pass, and they will live to return to their homes. At Wad Kauli, the grave counter will record 100 deaths today. Refugees who will never make it home.